Hey, welcome back to the Rock Fantasy YouTube channel and another of our interview series. I'm Stephen Keeler, your host of the long-running Rock Fantasy Record Shop here in Middletown, New York. I brought along Count Ralphus of the Hudson Valley Squares and Rock Fantasy YouTube channel to co-host this one. Today, we have the pleasure to sit down with one of the heavy metal legends, Steve Lips Kudlow. I hope I pronounced your last name. Hey. From the Canadian heavy metal band Anvil, and quite legendary, as we chat on the new album, One and Only. It's coming out June 28th on AFM Records. Welcome to the channel. It's an honor to have you on, Lips. And where are you joining us from today?
From my music room in my house in Toronto.
Cool. All right. So let's chat let's hear about this new album. That's what we're here for.
Okay, what do you want to know?
Well, what songs do you think stand out? Maybe some of the songs you plan on performing live that you're going to pick out. I know you did a video for a song. We can talk about that for the Feed Your Fantasy. And
I have my own favorites, and you know, it's sometimes it's different than maybe than the public would their perspective, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And it usually is. It's just that's just the way it is. And sometimes it's I don't play their favorite song, but it's they don't have to listen to it every day. I do. And if it's not your favorite, you got to change it to be so. It's pretty, you know, sometimes it could be iffy what you're choosing to play. So, but I think my favorite song is probably Truth Is Dying.
Okay.
But not necessarily, it's just for generally speaking, because I think that I like what it's doing musically, but aside from just liking what it does musically, it's what it's saying and what it's about.
I was going to ask you about that. What is the meaning behind that song? If you want to explain it to us a little bit.
Well, it's really the tip of the iceberg, isn't it? Mm-hmm. When you stop to think about it, because when you have no truth, okay, when truth becomes questionable, everything does.
Yes,
it's a domino effect.
Mm-hmm.
So nothing is believable. That's a very bad place to be.
And it's kind of where we are now in the modern day world.
Everything is questioned.
You don't know what to believe, but whether the news is the real news. Yeah, I agree with you 100%.
And it's not, but you're being misinformed. So who mm-hmm. are you voting for? You don't even know who you're voting for or what you're voting for.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, some of the themes that I'm talking about, condemned liberty, you know, it's about abusing our freedom.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what's changed our world is the abuse of all of our freedoms. It's okay to tell lies. It's okay to fill the internet full of bullshit and people believe it. That's okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, no, it's not. Because eventually what that turns into is then there's no truth left. That's what that turns into. Because mm-hmm. then, you know, I mean, the pandemic certainly increased that. I think, you know, like beyond ridiculous. I think to the point where we're pretty much hitting bottom.
Yeah, I agree with you about that, man. But it's just the current, we're in a shit show right now, I think, generally.
Yeah, and in America, it's like you watch the news on one channel and you get one side of a story. Then you watch it on a different channel. It's completely different. You don't know which one is the truth.
Yeah.
Or if either They just go with their agenda. They don't care about the truth no more.
Yeah.
No, no. The truth is whatever you want to believe.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah, exactly.
That, just saying that is the scariest part. And that's why, that's really the death of the free world, because, you know, as much as all the paranoia towards communism, you know, all that from our childhood, particularly for me, because I'm in my 60s, so I'm completely aware of, you know, the post-war years and all that.
Sure.
I grew up in the 60s and 70s, so I really, yeah, you know, that's the world I knew.
Yeah, I'm in my 60s too. I'm 63, so I'm right there with you.
Yeah, so it's what used to be is not what it is. It's not at all, and that's what's actually really scary, because you can't trust what you're reading. Or and the other thing is, a lot of this is caused by people not reading and not looking at stuff. That's how it really, really gains its momentum. The you know, lies and conspiracy theories is because people aren't actually reading about the facts about what they're talking about.
Yeah.
You know, it's quite phenomenal. And then you've got people in great positions of power making up shit.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Hey, you gotta wear a mask. It's gonna really help.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yeah, you know, for sure.
And those things, and that's why I say that the pandemic really, really, really brought that shit out more than
for sure.
A lot of poison with that, man.
A lot
of division with that too. Like people forcing people to get the vax, and where did it come from? And everything was they try to make everything like a conspiracy theory, and we didn't know what to believe. They just feed us all the lies that we want.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, even during it, even though people saw pictures, they're going, why are the hospitals empty? Because they wouldn't let anybody in.
Yeah, it was a hell of a mess.
Hey, listen, man, you know, the best is it was amazing. I got it right at the very beginning. At the beginning of the whole friggin' thing. We were in England, okay?
So you were on tour at the beginning of the pandemic also, right?
Yeah, right at the beginning of it, and it's just when it started to spread through Europe. It wasn't barely even happening in North America, but in Europe it was, in Italy was already devastated.
Mm-hmm.
So I get to the Heathrow Airport on March 18th, right?
Yeah.
And by the time I got to the check-in desk, they're not allowing flights into the USA unless you've got a US passport.
Oh.
And I had to catch a flight from New York to Toronto after British Airways to New York, and then a Delta flight from New York to Toronto. That's how the whole thing was supposed to work. So they go, we can't send you. You got to get another ticket.
Both.
So now I end up on my cell phone called back to my travel agent in Canada, and it's like 4 o'clock in the morning at home. And I got her on the phone, and she's going, listen, let me speak to the lady behind the desk at British Airways, right? So I hand my cell phone to the front line worker at British Airways in Heathrow Airport, who's been exposed to everybody and their dog, okay, just spit and breathed all over my fucking phone. And now I got COVID, okay?
Oh, boy.
So, and no one wanted to believe me. Everybody, the whole band, all the crew, everybody, no one else got sick except me. So where did I get it from? I'm the only one who lent my phone out.
Yeah, who knows? It was a mystery for sure. Yeah.
Well, that's no mystery to me. That's
true.
That's one and one is still two. That's all.
Yep.
So, but no one wanted to believe me. No one believed me.
Like, you're not sick.
No one believed me that I had COVID.
Oh, wow.
Because you couldn't get tested. So
okay.
I'm losing consciousness and passing out in my house. This is in the second week of it, right? And my wife calls the 911 and says, my husband just collapsed on the floor. And they go, is he breathing? And she yells up to me, Lips, are you there? And I'm going, what's going on? And I'm going, I fell. I'm not well. And she goes, okay, he's breathing. And said, okay, that's good. We're not coming.
Wow. Oh yeah, yeah.
Because they knew that if they're not bringing COVID into the hospital.
Yeah, yeah. Well, crazy.
They needed they're going, what's wrong with the guy? Well, he's been sick. He's got a fucking really bad cold, and he's fucking. They're going, don't bring him here. Forget it. Okay, attach him. No, don't bring him here.
I have some other friends that were over, and so we're way off subject on a new album now, but here we are. But I had other friends that were on tour in Europe. Robin Mazin, who is a merchandising and works with Exodus, plays in Gruesome. They were on the road with Exodus, Testament, and Death Angel. And Will Carroll was the first guy I ever interviewed on the channel.
It's interesting because we saw the Testament guys.
Okay.
Maybe two days before they got sick. Or they were sick.
Yeah, like, it was the same kind of situation with your band. Like Will ended up in the hospital. He was on, like, he was in an induced coma. We almost lost Will. But yeah, other people that were in the touring party didn't have any symptoms. But, that was COVID, I guess. But thank God we're past that now.
Yeah, yeah.
We can go out. We can see shows.
What we were talking about is the effect of that on
of course
on humanity, and we've lost all of our fucking trust in government, in what we hear on in our media, especially the media are the guys who set the fires.
Exactly. So for sure we got that message across, the truth is dying. So Feed Your Fantasy is obviously a much more lighthearted song, right?
Yeah, that particular song is just about doing what you love, and as much as you possibly can, because there's nothing else to live for.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
At the same time that we can talk about depressing things, you can talk about the things that are going to get you through, count your blessings.
For sure.
And go after the things and be celebrative about your happiness rather than sit there and go, I want more.
So how does the Steve one and Peter, only
Steve Peter's store is called Rock Fantasy, so that song goes good with his.
Yeah, we'll have to have you guys play out front there. Feed Your Fantasy at Rock Fantasy. But yeah, so where was the album recorded?
In Germany.
Oh, wow. Okay.
In the same place we've recorded the last couple, I guess. Not I guess, I did. At Jörg's Sound Lodge studio in Germany. That's, it's great. Awesome. Awesome on every level. I love we love it there. It's like a second home, and you know, we look forward to going back. We're going to go back, of course.
And you have a big tour plan through North America. Come, I think that's starting very soon. Correct, Lips?
Yeah. We're coming down to the States starting July 10th, I think it is.
Okay.
Yeah. So we got a number of shows, about 30 shows or something like that.
And who do you have on the road with you?
It's, I think it varies in different parts of the country. That's what the way that the agent did it.
Okay.
So there's a number of different supports in and along the tour, depending on what region we're in, is where different bands come in for a certain length of time, and then you go into another region and another band comes in for a while. You know what I mean? It's
not
good. Yeah.
We see that happen a lot now.
I think is a good thing. It gives the opportunity for bands from these different regions to get an opportunity, you know, to come out and play, because it's not that easy to get gigs these days.
How psyched are you to play Hellfest in 11 days? How psyched are you for that?
I am, to a certain level. A lot of trepidation, of course. It's nerve-wracking.
Okay.
That's got to be one of the biggest, it's
fun as a pig and shit. There's no question about that. But there's always the sort of gulp in the throat when you're thinking, oh man, no sound check. It's get on stage, get out there and hope everything runs smooth. You know, all those things. The technical,
wow, even a veteran like you,
no control like over.
I'm surprised a veteran like you still gets that feeling, but that's pretty good that you still do, I guess, you know.
No, it's because I care.
Yeah.
When you don't care, then you go, oh, whatever happens, happens. But I actually care. I want it to be the best it can be, and nothing less. So yes, and somebody's got to worry about it.
So do you have
a big crowd? That's like what's that, like 100,000 people at those fests?
Oh, a Hellfest! I think it's even more than that. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, don't tell me.
Don't tell you. It's only gonna be 25 people there. Don't worry.
Yeah. That's all I'm going to be able to see because
I mean, I've never been to it, but it's always
looking at. It's not like I can see individuals, that's for sure.
When you see that lineup every year for that, like, wow, look at these bands and how many bands are there. It's crazy. But hopefully you sell a ton of merchandise and make plenty of money.
Well, actually, you know, there's an interesting fact. We're not going to bring any merchandise to that.
Oh, no.
At all. They only allow you 25 t-shirts.
Really?
Yeah. Ah. If you're not a headlining band, they don't give you money for the t-shirts for 90 days.
Wow. That's weird. Okay.
There's a huge, huge process of checking in your stuff. You're only allowed, you know, if you're one of the bigger bands, then you're allowed to sell a number of items. But the small, anybody less than the first, you know, than the last three bands of the day, of any given day, they're allowed to have a number of items. But if you're let's say first, second, third, fourth band, fifth band, you're not allowed. You're allowed a t-shirts. That's one item.
Okay.
So the other thing is, there are so many bands. Okay. Sure. When you're a consumer at that festival, whose t-shirt are you buying?
Yeah.
Because they're upwards of $50 our money, maybe more, right?
Okay. Yeah. So okay.
You got to ask yourself, so how many are you going to sell anyway?
Yeah, with that much competition, like 200 bands or something like that, right?
Yeah.
That's and there's that many people. Yeah, there's and there's only so many dollars to go to any given one of those people to buy a shirt.
Yeah, so, of course.
I don't know. So just you certainly can't get with having an allotment of 25 shirts. It makes it difficult. How many large do we have? How many mediums do we have?
Yeah, that's very difficult. Yeah.
Right. So your chance of selling a lot of them is way gone because you're completely got limitations to what your stock is, and that's how the end that end of the business. So what we did is we just went, you know, when it all said and done, and when you look at all these different aspects of what this is, we're just not going to bother.
Yeah,
it makes sense.
You know, we come through France while we're touring anyway. If you want a T-shirt of Anvil, we can
sure fix
it. We come through on our own, which we will, and we do. So that's the way that has to work. Unless they had some other way of doing the business, then I could see it being feasible.
Yeah.
You know,
if I went to a fest like that with that many bands, I would go for the event shirt with all the bands on it instead of trying to buy just
a couple. That's a good point because a lot of people will buy that one. Yep, for sure.
How do you got to look at it from the promoter's point of view. How else are you going to organize all this shit? How else? So they're right. There's only one. You have to have stipulations like that. How big? How many stacks of T-shirts are you going to do for a band that's only going to sell 5 shirts? You know what I mean?
Yep, for sure. So what else? Anything else you want to talk about the new album? Any other songs you want to highlight before we move on to a couple questions that Ralph has?
I don't know. Just hit me with the questions.
Hit you with the questions. All right. So I'm going to tell you about one thing I mentioned before we went on air. I remember seeing you guys way back in the day in Port Jervis, New York, at the State Theater. And I still have a concert flyer somewhere from it. Do you remember that gig?
Yeah, I remember it.
Yeah, okay. Long time ago, my wife and I think we weren't even married yet. It was probably like 1981, maybe. Am I right? I don't. Ralph, you remember? Ralph probably got the flyer there.
No, I was only 11 in 81, but I would imagine that was.
Actually, it would have been 83.
83 it was. 83. Okay, 83. Yeah, all blends together when you get older.
Yeah, my first time ever seeing you was in 83. I was only 13 years old, and it was my first underground concert I ever went to, first like club concert. My friend's dad bring me and another friend to the club, and I guess he said we were allowed to go in because they served beer in there. It was JB's Rock 3 in Middletown, where Rock Fantasy is located. And we were loving it. The band Pierce opened up. And we were loving the show, but it was running a little late. And my friend's father came into the club looking for us to take us home. And we were like hiding behind. We were the only little kids there. So we were hiding behind all the big people. We wanted to watch as much show as we could. So we kept avoiding his dad. And then you pulled out the vibrator and started doing the solo right as he found him. And he was like, come on, we're out of here. So it got cut off a little bit. Years later, I met you at a March Metal Meltdown, Asbury Park in New Jersey. I got this old Polaroid with me and my friend Rob Jentsch from Morpheus Descends.
Oh, wow.
We were both very happy to meet you. You got a cigarette in your nose here. It's hard to see, but great memory of.
I was at that gig.
I told him how I was at, seen him when I was a little kid, and he was like, oh, cool. He was really cool. He gave us a couple of minutes to say hello. And then the movie comes out and you guys are all over the place. And I like you were talking about being nervous. I would love to hear how nervous were you when you got to open up for AC/DC at Giant Stadium. I was at that show and it was unbelievable. I was so happy that you guys were on that show. I wish you would have got the whole tour. But if you got any kind of memory to talk about of that, I'd love to hear it.
What, of the actual AC/DC show?
Yeah, Giant Stadium.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty, it's pretty bizarre, that shit, man, you're doing that. It's almost like you're, I don't know, it's almost like it's in a dream. And then I guess afterwards it is like it was a dream. Because you're never going to see it again. You know, you're not going to see that moment again.
And especially in America, playing in front of that many people in America. You know, I lived it
in such a way that I knew that it was going to be, I'm never going to do it again.
Was it professionally filmed? I've never seen like footage from that show.
No, wow. No. They didn't allow.
Oh.
Which is kind of fucking sad, you know?
Yeah, because everything gets
they were gonna put it on Nightline or ABC. They refused to let us film anything. Not even with our, I think Sasha filmed a few seconds with his cell phone, but even that wasn't.
Yeah, actually, no cell phones were filming back then. So that's why I wondered if somebody had like a big video camera filming. And it, you know, that was, or maybe there was a cell phone back then. I can't remember. But
I'm sure there was. There was. Right,
yeah. What year was that?
You can find footage.
Or 2010. So.
I remember that.
After the movie came out. But, yeah, I was reading I got the book, which I really loved. I'm reading it again for the second time this week because I was getting psyched to talk to you today. And of course I got the movie. But one of the things I was thinking about was how you talk about in the book how you got offered to replace Fast Eddie when he was leaving the band in Motorhead. And right. You would have been on Another Perfect Day. If that would have been the first thing you would have did with them, if you did join, when you listen to that album today, do you think constantly about like what you would have done differently, or is it weird listening to that album for you?
It wouldn't have been what that album is. You know, it would have been songs also from Forged in Fire. Right, would have ended up on it because that's what I was in the midst of doing.
Okay,
so where am I doing that? Am I doing Free as the Wind with Motorhead?
I would imagine it would have been a lot heavier an album. At the time, it got a bad, like people said, it was too slick sounding and they didn't really like it right away. Now it's considered a classic.
Because it's a one of a kind album. And that comes back to the title of our album, you know, One and Only. If an album isn't a one and only, then you didn't do a good job. Right? Everything has to be outstanding and one of a kind so that it shouldn't get repeated. And that's what makes something stand out. And that album stands out. Another Perfect Day stands out. It just does. It's not usual Motorhead. Not really.
Yeah, mainly Robbo being in the band.
It had a lot. I think it had a character that no other Motorhead album ever had. Or ever had after it.
Yeah.
That's what that was. And really, that's, you can really get the idea that that's what Lemmy depends on the guitar player to bring stuff. And I think that he arranged the music so that it could be so that it made sense to him. Whatever riffs the guitar player did, okay, we would do five of those, three of those, two of the, you know, whatever. He gave the direction of how to put the song together and arrange it so that he could sing it. Because he's the singer. He's going to be, if anybody's going to know how to arrange the song, it's the singer. So you could, but you could, that was Brian's input that we're hearing that you don't hear anywhere else because it's the only place that Brian played. So that's what you get. And that can be said about Eddie Clark. Once Eddie left, there was never songs like Eddie Clark riffs. There's just not. There's not. Phil Campbell is a great reflection to myself. I know that he likes a lot of the same music, that's for sure. And I know that he has a similarity in his guitar vocabulary as I do. Even in Bastard Sons, there's things that go that sounds like one of my riffs. And certainly we're fans of each other and have been all along, right? So it as well as being friends, but I mean it's what it is. It's what it is. You know, I didn't get to play with Motorhead. Oh well. Next time. Next life.
Yeah.
When I've been listening to all the old Anvils all week, like in preparation for this, and there's a lot of times where I could see why Lemmy thought of you when I would hear some of your leads early on and stuff, and you just had that Motorhead vibe without like the band really sounding like Motorhead, but your guitar playing definitely, I could totally see where, and plus you were playing shows with them back then, so he was watching you on stage and seeing how good of stage presence you had. So I just always can't help but wonder what it would have been like with you on that album.
I think there's a lot of people that wonder, but we're never going to know. And we're going to have to live with that. But it at the same time, then it would have changed the path of both bands. Yeah. Certainly. To be completely honest, I think it ended up the way it's supposed to. That's it. But here we are talking about it. Mm-hmm. So I think it still has a significance. I still think that it's significant, and it did have it still has some kind of weight to it, even way after the fact and way after the idea that I never did it. You know what I mean? We're talking about something I never did. Mm-hmm. You know, it's pretty fascinating that that it's still subject. You know what I mean? It's still a subject that we choose to talk about. I think that there's something fascinating about that in itself.
It's kind of like all the people that have auditioned for Ozzy throughout the years. It's like, even though they had a 10-minute audition, like that's part of their story that they at least were trying to get into the band or whatever. But it's definitely connected to your story. And even the Lee Aaron thing, people probably don't think of that as much because they didn't get as huge or as legendary as Motorhead, but they were really big at the time. They were having gold albums and stuff in Canada, right? And that would have been a big opportunity, but you stuck with your brother, Rob. And
that was an opportunity too, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've recorded 20 albums and didn't interrupt it.
No. Nope.
Somebody else's party and trying to use it to make myself bigger. Just the sort of selfishness of it all in a sense. I don't like the smell of it. I don't like the smell of it. I think that the right things happened, and there is no regret. There's no regret. If there's any regret, it's that I didn't get to play with my friend Lemmy. But that's it's more of a personal thing rather than a professional thing, right? It's like it might have been fun to just even to just sit and create some stuff with the guy. It might have been really, really cool. Who knows? We'll never know. But that would be the only thing. It would be to attain that I didn't get. That's the only regret. It's not that I didn't do that. It's more that I didn't get the opportunity to do it as well, you know, sort of, but not affect what I've done. You know what I mean? It's like, you're not given choices like that. Hindsight's always 20/20. So it's like, went the right way. That's it.
It's a great honor that he even thought of you, though. So that you'll always have that he was thinking of you.
it was a funny guy, man. You don't see him for 10 years and he comes up, he hugs me and he goes, "The family and the strange, but family nonetheless."
Sure. Ralph, anything else you'd like to ask him before we kind of wind us down?
This one's a kind of a weird one. So when I was rereading the book, we have a regular on our channel, John McEntee from the death metal band Incantation. He hosts this channel sometimes. And they were playing Middletown back in the 90s. It was the band Grave was headlining, and the band Fear of God was on the tour with them. And in your book, I was reading how you had a short relationship with Dawn Crosby. It was like you were warned before you went to hang out with her that she was like a little out there. You said something in your book, I think it was like Steve Harris's girlfriend or wife at the time was like, "Oh, stay away from that one, Lips." But I was just wondering, because I asked John McEntee when he was on the show one time, I said, how come they Fear of God wasn't on that show? I had the flyer, they were supposed to play, I had their CD, I was going to go see Fear of God. And we get there and they were off the tour. He said she was so out of control with the drinking and going crazy that she drove the rest of the band nuts. And while they were on tour, they stopped at like a rest stop for her to go to the bathroom. And then they just drove home and left the tour, the band. And they left her at the rest stop because they said she was like smashing bottles and drunk all the time. But I just was wondering if like you were warned, but was she like that crazy, like even way back then when you knew her, or was that a totally different like time?
You know what? I don't think she was really. She was really not crazy at all, but she hadn't done anything yet. Like she didn't go crazy yet.
Yeah.
But I think the path that she was on. You know, she lived in a squatter house, in a squatter apartment. In England, you know, an extension cord for electricity in an apartment. Somehow these people brought electricity in, and there's not even electricity. I'm not even sure if there was windows, to tell you the truth. It looked like it was a pretty condemned place that I went and visited. And that was all in a fight to try to make it. And she had told me that she was in a band with some Swedish guys at the time. I don't.
Detonate, I think, maybe, with the band.
Pardon me?
The band was Detonate, I think.
Yeah, it could be.
It was their first band.
Yeah, it could be. For some reason, I have a recollection of her telling me that it was a Swedish guys that she was going to be working with, and her whole reason was like she came from San Francisco and she came to London, and that's where she was staying. I mean, that takes a a lot of balls, man, to have done that for a girl that's fucking, I don't know, 18, 19 years old, has gone to London, England with fuck all money and is living in a squatter house. That's rough shit, man. That's, when I look at it today, okay, was I that judgmental then? No, you know, met her at the festival, and then she gave me a phone number, and then she gave me her address, and I took the train, the what do you call it, the underground to her place, and it was into an area of the city where there were condemned buildings, and I had to find a condemned building and the apartment, and I did. And that's where she was living. Pretty remarkable. I mean, can I say that I had it? No, it was short, very short lived, because I was only in England for a week or two. Because we were supposed to have been there. We were supposed to have gone on tour with Def Leppard, and the tour fell apart. So we had played the Monsters of Rock, the Donington Festival, and we played two nights at the Marquee. But we were there for 2 weeks, something like that. So we sat around for a whole fucking week. It was during that week that we kind of hung out for a bit. So I took her to a party that was at the Queen's cousin's place.
Yeah, that's in the book. I remember reading about that. It was a bunch of rock stars there, right?
Yeah, yeah. And that was like a hangout place for all the rock stars, not just me. And just unbelievable that who that guy was and how the hell we met him is beyond understanding. It's whatever. You know what I mean? You're 25 years old, and some guy in his 40s is hanging out behind a festival in a parking lot with a safari, like a real safari van. Right, with all the camouflage on it and the whole fucking bit. Right, standing out there smoking a joint or something, and we see this guy, and he calls us over, and he's smoking the joint with him, and he goes, and we find out he's the Queen's cousin. You know what I mean? And he says, "Come on, you know, let's hang out and shit." So we start hanging out with the guy. He was like this cool older guy.
It sounds really interesting. Sasha needs to do a documentary about that guy. Hear all his crazy stories.
And it's interesting because we introduced Sasha to that guy, and that's one of many things that, you know, those 2 weeks in London changed a lot of people's lives, including my own. I could go on and on and on, but whatever.
That's what's great about the book, is how it leads from like something like that leads to a documentary movie in 2009 coming out that is like been copied so many times now by other bands, and you know it's just going to keep being copied as soon as bands can get somebody to do a documentary like that. It really changed the way we look at a lot of musical documentaries, you know.
Yeah, that's, yeah, of course. But you know what? You know what the problem is? Is not looking carefully. They're not a lot of the guys making these documentaries are not watching carefully. They're not paying attention to the right thing.
Yeah.
If you want your documentary to have significance, you've got to. You've got to take a lot of risks. And what does that mean? Well, that means that You don't sit there and go do a retrospect. No one gives a shit about a band's history. Not really. You need some testimonials, but you don't make a documentary of testimonials. That just doesn't. It's hogwash shit. It's boring. Okay, who cares what other people think after a certain point? A few key characters show what they think. Let's hear what they say. Onward. But the predominant major part of any documentary should be something that's in the present, working towards a future, not dwelling and sitting there talking about all your past conquests, your conquests, because everybody knows those conquests anyway. You're not giving anything new. What they want to see and what they want to watch is what is going to happen next. What can you, and that's what I mean by risk. Can you run film and run cameramen taking the risk that there might not be anything to film? It's taking that risk. It's filming everything and anything. And
yeah, that documentary had showed so many things that you didn't think.
Having a focal point of where you want something to go. In other words, it's not about what Anvil did. It's what Anvil doing and what are they going to do. And they made a movie about that. That's why that worked. You're not watching it in retrospect. You're watching it like you're living it with the band as they're living it. And that's what the difference is.
Cool.
Yeah, the structure of that documentary is unbelievable. And there's so much heart in it, and it's the way they showed the bad side of everything. It wasn't like a lot of times with bands, they don't want anybody to see the bad side. They just want to see, like you said, their conquest, their accomplishments, and everybody talking about how great they are. But they don't want to show the reality of them working their 9-to-5 job and the fist, almost getting in a fist fight with their band partner there, and all that kind of stuff. That it, the structure of the way Sasha did that was brilliant. And I know what you mean when you say
it's pure, honest reality. And that's something that you generally don't see anywhere. Then it goes back to the talking about what happened to truth. Truth is dying. I wrote a song about it.
There you go. Well, anyhow, it's been great having you on the channel. I think we're starting to run low on time here, right? You got another appointment soon?
Yeah, 11 minutes.
11 minutes. So, of course, we better start wrapping it up soon, and hopefully we can get to chat with you again down the road. But anything, this is albums coming out. It's coming out on vinyl, CD, and everything else. Are there going to be special variants of the record, or anything like that we're to talk about?
Okay, special. What was that?
Special variants of the vinyl. Like sometimes they make different colors that are exclusive.
That shit going on. Yeah, there's splatter or clear. Okay. they got a bunch of them. So, yeah, some people collect all of them.
They do.
But the thing is, there's only like 300 of stuff. You know, in some cases, there's only 300. So. Yeah. Yeah, you got to grab it before they're gone. It's simple as that.
And where can we find them other than in a record store like mine, which that's not out yet, but can you pre-order this through your website? Or?
Oh, absolutely. You got to go look up AFM Records and order it directly from them. That's your best bet.
Okay.
Because I don't know whether you're going to be able to get the weird off-colored vinyl stuff any other way, to tell you the truth. I don't I don't know.
Of course.
I don't have knowledge.
And how do we find you, the band Anvil, on the web?
Well, there's, you can just Google it, and you can find us on Facebook, and you can find our fan site, which is run by a guy that's been running it since 1996.
Cool. That's cool. Sounds like my web guy. Been running it for years.
The format of the actual, it's lovely because the format of the website is like from 1996. And I think it's really cool that he's done it, that he's left it alone. Because everything is there that you need to see. Oh, you want to look at tour dates? Tour dates. You want to look at, what's their address to their booking agents? Oh, there it is. Everything that needs to be there, it's there. So it's just not flash and fancy like everybody else.
Yeah, cool. So we mentioned the North American tour. We mentioned you're doing the Hellfest dates. Do you have any other tours planned this year in Europe or festivals?
I guess that we're going to be in Europe from something like from the beginning of October to the beginning of December. So
okay.
So we're going to be pretty damn busy.
Keep an eye out on the website for that then.
Yeah, the Facebook page, and we usually keep it always posted. There's an Instagram and there's Twitter. So we're on them. You can find it.
Excellent. Just look
at my Anvil and you can find us.
Well, it's been an honor to sit down with you on the Rock Fantasy YouTube channel today, and we'll get this video up in a day or two and help spread the word a little bit. And Ralph, thanks for being on. And Lips, it was good to meet you again. It's been many years since I probably last time I saw you might have been that metal. What was it? The New Jersey? What was the Metal Fest? Or what you have, Ralph? That picture from?
The March Metal Meltdown.
March Metal Meltdown, it used to be called. Yep, and they were originally at the Asbury Park Convention Hall. I remember they were in Pensauken. They were all and moved them all around for a while. They were.
Yeah, which one were you at?
Which one was that, Ralph?
I went to the first three of them, but I went to the three Asbury Park ones. Is the ones that I went to.
Yeah.
But I remember it was amazing, the stage that you played on. It was like, I might get them mixed up from the other dates, but it would be like the Saxon, Raven, Anvil, Manowar, like all on like the old school stage. And it was like the whole day, I ended up spending the whole day in there catching all the legendary bands, you know, all the newer bands on the other stages.
Yeah, you people the battle of the gigs, because we did one that they had two bands going in the same room.
I was at that one, Lips. I remember that. There was like a curtain between you and them.
Yeah, absolutely.
I was like, I can hear the other guy singing louder than I can hear myself.
I remember that day. I was there. It looked like it was like in an old strip mall, like an old Caldor department store or something.
It's fucked up, man.
Yep.
That's fucked up shit, man. To me, that's like, wow, what a memory that was.
I remember that one.
I don't know how the hell we did, man, but it was unfucking believable.
I can remember you were playing the same time as another band, and I was watching. I'm like, yes, go through the curtain, and you see Anvil, and you go through the curtain, and there's a death metal band or something playing on the other side.
And the sound was completely fucked up because
of course. Yeah, that was a one and done festival. I think I remember running into Jasmine St. Clair. She was there, and I hadn't seen her in years, and she was emceeing it or something. You know, and I used to do Chiller Theater, and she was a vendor there. And I'm like, "You were at Chiller Theater?" She's like, "No, I wasn't." And then later on, she goes, "Oh yeah, I was there." Well, anyhow, we better wrap this up because we're running out of time, and you got to go hop on and talk to somebody else.
Yeah, in 5 minutes.
All right, man. So we'll see you next time. Hit like, hit subscribe, all that good stuff, and go out and support Anvil this summer. Right. Boom.
Bye-bye.
Yeah.